Good morning. It's lovely to be with you. It's lovely to have some time to be apart. You may notice I've changed from my classic and surplus to my classic garb. That must mean summer's arrived because this is cooler. I only wear the classic now because it's warm, the classic and surplus, sorry, because it's warmer. So let's be still for a moment and perhaps remember that in the warmth of the sunshine, we embrace the warmth of God's love, and that he invites us to ascend with him into the heavenly realms through his son Jesus, himself rose from the dead and ascended to be with God our Father. And we proclaim him as our Lord and our King. And so we sing our first hymn, it's number 137. Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon the throne, number 137. Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem rings, for music God is on. Awake my soul and sing of him who died for me, and endless my righteous King to all eternity. Found in the Lord of love, he always stands and sings. He We turn to our red service books and page one. We meet together in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Alleluia. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Over the page, we pray together, prayer at the top of that. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are in, all desires, and from whom
the secret side,
cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify the Lord of peace,
through Christ our Lord.
Let's kneel or sit as we continue in prayer. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "The first commandment is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. And the second is this: love your neighbour as yourself. There's no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." Amen. Lord, in a few moments of silence, we examine our hearts. What God has prepared for those who love him, he is revealed to us through the Spirit, for the Spirit searches everything. Therefore, let us in penitence open our hearts to the Lord, who has prepared good things for those who love him. We join in together with the prayer at the top of page 3. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father,
we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thoughts and word and deed.
Through negligence, through weakness, our own deliberate heart, we are truly sorry and repent
of our sins for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ,
who died for us. Forgive us all that is past and grant that we may serve you in the newness of life to the glory of God. The knowledge of God's loving kindness, his grace and his mercy, we ask that he would speak to our hearts the reassurance of forgiveness. Almighty God forgives all who truly repent. He has had mercy upon you, pardoned and delivered you from all your sins, is confirming and strengthening you in all goodness, and he will keep you in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. With knowledge of the fact that we are forgiven and accepted and loved, we stand and praise God together in the words of the Glory. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people.
Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. We call it for today, the seventh Sunday after Easter, the Sunday after Ascension Day. O God, the King of glory, you have exalted your only Son, Jesus Christ, with great triumph to your kingdom in heaven. We beseech you, leave us not comfortless, but send your Holy Spirit to strengthen us and exalt us to the place where our Saviour Christ is gone before, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Be seated for our first lesson.
The first lesson is from Acts chapters 15 to 17 and 21 to 26. In those days, Peter stood among the believers. Together, the crowd numbered about 120 people. He said, "Friends, the scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit through David foretold concerning Judas, who became a guide for those who arrested Jesus. For he was numbered among us and was allotted his share in this ministry. So one of the men who has accompanied us throughout the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John until the day when he was taken up from us. One of these must become a witness with us to his resurrection." So they proposed two: Joseph, called Barsabbas, who was also known as Justus, and Matthias. Then they prayed and said, "Lord, you know everyone's heart. Show us which one of these two you have chosen to take the place in this ministry and apostleship from which Judas turned aside to go his own place." And they cast lots for them, and the lot fell on Matthias, and he was added to the 11 apostles. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Next hymn is on your sheets. My Jesus, my Saviour, shout to the Lord. I'm going to go to the hospital. If you're able, would you like to remain standing for the gospel?
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful people and kindle in them the fire of your love.
Hallelujah.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus looked up to heaven and prayed, Father, I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you. For the words that you gave to me, I have given to them, and they have received them and know in truth that I came from you. And they have believed that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I'm not asking for behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one. While I was with them, I protected them in your name that you have given me. I guarded them, and not one of them was lost, except the one designed to be lost, so that the scripture might be fulfilled. But now I am coming to you, and I speak these things in the world so that they may have my joy made complete in themselves. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them because they do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. I'm not asking you to take them out of the world, but I ask you to protect them from the evil one. They do not belong to the world, just as I do not belong to the world. Sanctify them in truth. Your word is truth. As you have sent me into the world, So I have sent them into the world. And for their sakes, I sanctify myself, so that they also may be sanctified in truth. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Open our hearts, our minds, and our lives to your word, Lord, that it may bring forth good fruit. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. Up until the time of Jesus, the religious people in that area at that time had a very simple understanding of the nature of God and the nature of the world in which they lived. And they saw them as being in conflict with each other, and that God was holy, set apart and precious and special and amazing, and the world around was not like that at all, and actually was not very nice. I think it's probably a polite way of putting it. And the religious people were afraid. And their fear came from the fact that they wanted to stay close to God, who was holy and amazing and majestic, and they didn't want to get infected and affected by the world in which they lived. And so they started creating rules and regulations. I mean, they were given the rules and regulations. Love God with all your heart, mind, and soul and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. And then they started saying, well, that's difficult to do, so let's make some more regulations around it, which just makes life easy. And gradually they began to make more and more regulations just in case they went a bit too close to where the boundary was. I don't know if you've ever walked one of those cliff edge paths, and there's a rope and there's a sign which says, do not cross this line, danger of cliff fall. The reason why that sign is there is because from that side, the other side, it's dangerous. But if you're an ultra cautious sort of person, you see the sign there and you think, well, I'll walk this way a little bit. And you gradually move further and further away from the edge of the cliff, because just in case something bad might happen, I'm not going to go there. And that's in effect what they did. They began to move the path further and further away from where they perceived danger to be. And they had all these rules and all these regulations, and they were all ended up being a barrier to the people of God being involved in God's world. There was a distinct separation, because they were so afraid that the world would affect them and infect them. And along comes Jesus, and he blows their understanding out of the mind, out of them, out of the water. Because all of a sudden, he's not just standing on the very edge, but actually he's going over the other side of the line sometimes. And as he does that, the world doesn't infect him, but he begins to change the world in which he treads. He begins to move the boundary further and further back, because the danger is moved away. And all the rules and all the regulations that the religious people think were really important begin to lose their importance, because actually Jesus changes the world. He brings about the kingdom of God. That's what we pray, isn't it? Let your kingdom come. As he brings the kingdom, the boundaries are pushed back. The loving kindness of God, instead of being affected by the sinfulness of the world, transforms that sinfulness into the holiness of the Father. That God's loving kindness begins to change the world around. And people who are lost are rescued. People who are sick are healed. People who are caught up in all sorts of other things begin to be rescued from their situation. And sin is broken. And the consequences of sin is broken. And so all of a sudden you get this picture where the world is beginning to be transformed by Jesus. And then Jesus, in the prayers in John's gospel, begins to pray for the disciples and says, in the same way that I've been in the world but not of the world, in other words, I'm beginning to infect and affect it, so I pray for my disciples, those who will follow on from me, that they too might not be afraid of the world, but rather go into the world to love and to serve, to infect it and affect it with the goodness of the Father, so that the world begins to be transformed, so that the kingdom begins to come. And Jesus' prayer is, Lord, protect them as they go out into the world. so that the world doesn't destroy them, but that so they transform the world. And it's really interesting that the key thing that it seems that Jesus is worried about them being affected by in the world is not sin or anything like that. It's simply that they may be one. There's something about unity and the kingdom of God which is profoundly important. There is a danger that sometimes we think of our story in the life of the church as being a solitary journey. And in fact, what happens very often, and one of the signs of sinfulness, if you like, is selfishness. It's all about me and what I want and what I need. And we begin to get people arguing because, well, what I want is more important than what they want is more important. That's how politics seems to work at the moment, isn't it? That we move into this selfish world where it's all about me. And when you do that, relationships get broken, because that's the point of the commandments, isn't it? The commandments are given so that we might have good relationships with God, that we might have good relationships with neighbours, have good relationships with our families, so that then we might have good relationships with ourselves. If I start stealing from you, you're not going to like me. If I start lying to you, we're going to have a breakdown in relationships. Those rules are there to keep the relationships whole, that we might be united. And when the world comes in, it tends to push us into division and push us into deciding, well, that's more important than that. And those things begin to separate the people of God. The world gets in subtly into the life of the church. And so all of a sudden, instead of taking God's transforming love out into the world, we argue about truth, whatever truth might be. And we get ourselves into discussions about where we fall out with each other. Jesus uses this lovely phrase, and I have to remember very often. He says, they strain out gnats and swallow camels. And sometimes we get so caught up in the little things that we forget the big thing. And the big thing is simply this, that we love one another as the Father has loved us. So we love the Father, and we love ourselves, and we love each other. That we might be one, so that then we might begin to infect and affect the community around us. So when we pray for thy kingdom to come over these few days for the leading up to Pentecost, as we pray and walk around our villages and things like that, we're praying that something of the goodness of God, the light of God, the love of God, would begin to infect and affect our communities. That more people might discover that the love of God is for them, that the grace of God is for them, that the joy of the Lord is for them, that the peace of the Lord is for them, that they might find a place within God's people. And because we are one, a welcome, a place of inclusion, a place of love and kindness and goodness. But also that they get infected by the holiness of God, so that the things which are problematic begin to be resolved. In the same way that the things which are problematic in my life begin to get resolved the longer I spend in the kingdom of God. I don't become perfect overnight. I don't grow up. When I become a Christian, I don't become perfect just like that. I have to grow into the likeness of Jesus. And it's the same for all of us. And yet so often we're very intolerant of each other's differences. We're intolerant of the journeys which people are making. We assume that if they're a Christian, they've got to do it like that or like this. This, you can't do that. Have you ever heard this? You can't, if you're a Christian, you can't do that. Paul says in Romans, I can do anything I like, but not everything's good for me. And somehow we have to work out what's good for me in the kingdom of God. But the bottom line of it is that we can transform the world, and the world doesn't have to transform us and mold us into this image, because we have the loving kindness and the goodness of God in our hearts and lives. And so when we pray for our villages, we're praying, Lord, let that come in us so that it might then go out into the community, that we might transform them. It was lovely this morning. I was at Berkby at first thing this morning. And because the sun was shining and it was nice and warm, which is a change, I have to confess, that they were, I was in church waiting for everybody to come in, and they somehow had all gathered out in the churchyard, and as they were coming in, they kept sort of talking to each other. And at 2 minutes before the service was due to start, they were all outside having great fun and great laughter because they were outside of the building. And then they all came in, they were like, because they thought, and I thought, actually, there's a real picture there. That the light, That's what we should be. We're the people out there because we have the presence of God within us. Letting God's love transform us and transform our communities. But it starts with us knowing that we're in, that we have been infected and affected, not by the world, but by Jesus. And that his loving kindness and grace and mercy is poured out upon us so that then we can take it out into the world. And that we can do that together, because it's so much easier when you do it with other people. That's why they brought more people into the fellowship of the disciples, because they needed more people. And actually, if you read through the story, there were at least 400 people who were disciples at that point who Jesus appeared to before the ascension. It's not 12 or even 11. It wasn't even the 12 and the women. But there were lots of people who were included in the kingdom of faith at that point as well. And then it expanded and grew. So you're included. But if you have that little voice inside you, like I do sometimes, which says, well, perhaps not as much as somebody else. Yes, it's true, but it doesn't feel like it's true for me. And my prayer is that we would know that we are included, but also those around us are also included. That together we'd experience the kingdom of God. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we ask that you would pour out upon us in fresh ways and new ways the knowledge of your loving kindness, the knowledge of your goodness, the knowledge of the fact that we are included and we have been infected and affected by Jesus, and his power and his life is in us and through us. Then equip us to serve you and each other and the world. That knowing we are called, we might go and transform the world in your name. For we ask it in your precious name. Amen. And so we turn to page 7 of our service books. We affirm our faith together in the words of the Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven, of all that is seen and unseen.
We believe in our Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten and not made, of one being with Father, through whom all things were made, for us and for our salvation.
He came down to heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit
and the Virgin Mary,
and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered dead and was buried.
On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead,
and his kingdom will have no end.
We believe in the Holy Spirit,
the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Amen.
Let's kneel or sit as we pray together. We remember that Jesus came to love and to serve, and that many in the church are called to love and to serve. Both those in the roles that they take on to enable the church to run well as a building, as a community, but those who work hard to ensure that it works well in the community around, with acts of kindness and service. So we pray for those whose role ensures the smooth running of our churches, especially for those who've taken on roles on PCCs, and safeguarding, finance, those who take on roles in making sure that the church is cleaned, tea and coffee is made, the community around is cared for. Those who help with worship, and those who serve by loving their neighbours and their friends. We pray for each that they may be equipped by the Holy Spirit. Father, we pray for all who serve. Lord, in your mercy,
hear.
We pray for world leaders, for our politicians who lead our country, for those elected to represent our local communities. May they see their positions as a calling. May their potential be invested in seeking the good of others and serving the communities that they are part of. In the church, in the world, and in places where we live, help us to see the potential in ourselves and in others. Help us to know how to live and work together, that we may be united in good things. Help us to recognize the good things that each of us bring, even though they're different. And help us and others to bring their gifts and skills for the good of communities. We pray for all who serve. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
We pray for those who are ill, those in hospital, those at home. Those who struggle with anxiety and fear and depression. For those who are lonely. For those who grieve. We pray for those who seek to serve them. For those who serve in hospitals and surgeries. Those who serve in the community, bring loving kindness and goodness. For those who serve with Meals on Wheels and visiting, we pray that God would equip them and heal those who they go to. We pray for all who serve. Lord, in your mercy, hear. We pray for all who are in war-torn areas of the world. We ask for strength for those whose career or voluntary calling leads them into danger or conflict. Uphold them in their work to serve, to save, and to preserve. Help them to see that the sick are tended and the hungry fed, and grant them and their charges safety and everything they might need to ease suffering and pain, and to bring peace and reconciliation and justice. We pray for all who serve. Lord, in your mercy, hear. We pray for the work of Christian Aid, but also the other agencies who work to raise not just funds to care, but awareness. Pray that they would be equipped as they love and serve others, and that people would be equipped with the knowledge of how things work, and that we would be equipped with a generous heart to support and care for them. Father, we pray for all who serve. Lord, in your mercy.
Yeah.
We pray for ourselves. Pray for the equipping of the kingdom of God, God's Holy Spirit, that in the places where we love and serve others, we might know God's goodness and work in our hearts, that we might be equipped with wisdom, might be equipped with God's Holy Spirit to know the right words to say, that we might be equipped with compassion and kindness, also that we might know the service of others and let them serve us even as we serve others. We pray for all who serve. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Just remind you that we'll be prayer walking around Appleton, Wiske. I want to say on Wednesday. I'm just going to check I've got that right. Yes, 15th is Wednesday, which is also the press date for the magazine, if you've got articles you need to get in for that. And then also to remind you that there is the concert at Danby Wiske, at Birkby on Sunday morning, Saturday evening, with no added sugar. If you want tickets, I've got some with me, so you don't even have to worry about trying to contact someone. You see me at the end of this morning. And then also... Who would like to stand? We are all one in Christ Jesus. We belong to him through faith. We are heirs of the promise of the Spirit of peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
You might like to share with those around you a sign of peace. Our offertory hymn is number 12. Alleluia, sing to Jesus. Hymn number 12.
Thank you.
We're using this morning prayer B on page 22. Prayer B on page 22. Heavenly Father, we bring before you the fruits of our labours, the fruits of your creation, and the offering of our lives. For all things come from you, O Lord, and of your own do we give you. The Lord is here.
His spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift thanks to the Lord.
Let's give thanks to the Lord our God.
Right,
Father, we give you thanks and praise through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, to whom you have created all things, and who was sent by you in your great goodness to be our Saviour. By the power of the Holy Spirit into flesh, as your Son born of the Blessed Virgin, he lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms for us upon the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us, and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. So he fulfilled your will, and won for you, our holy people. And now we give you thanks, that after he had ascended far above all heavens, and was seated at your right hand in majesty, he sent forth upon the universal church your holy and life-giving spirit, that through his glorious power, the joy of the everlasting gospel might go forth into all the world. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, Holy,
holy, holy, God, our heavens,
heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Granted by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave it thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, to shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink, in remembrance of me. Great is the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
So, Father, calling to mind Jesus' death upon the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. We offer you our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. We bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. And the Holy Spirit on your people, and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and this one cup, so that we in the company of all the saints may praise and glorify you forever, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever.
Amen.
Going back to page 12, we kneel or sit. We pray together the prayer that Jesus himself has taught us, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be
thy kingdom come,
thy will be done, on earth as it is in
heaven. Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us.
Jesus, bearer of our sins, have mercy on us.
Jesus, Redeemer,
grant us peace.
So we draw near with faith, receiving the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave us, and his blood, which he shed for us. We eat and drink in remembrance that he died for us. Feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Alleluia. Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
You in communion. There's an album we'll play for us, Be Still for the Presence of the Lord. Please feel free to join in or just let the word speak to you. Also invite all who love the Lord Jesus to share with us in bread and wine. If however you'd rather not take communion, because I still invite you to come forward for a prayer of blessing, if you could bring your service book with you. And just to be aware that it's really difficult to come to the centre of the communion area. So if you go either that side or that side, it means I can then walk around the back and not have to lean across. Now let's join together in the prayer in the middle of page 50. Most merciful one, your love confess.
Our hands were clean, our hearts were unprepared. We will not think that he needs to cry on us in our needless sin. With you, Lord, our God, our Son,
and share your strength
with sins,
so then as he leads us with the precious oil and blood of the Son. That he may be us and we be the meat, and that we with the whole company of Christ may sit in hand and eat your Lord.
Thank you.
Eternal God, giver of love and power, your Son Jesus Christ has sent us into all the world to preach the gospel of his kingdom. Confirm us in this mission and help us to live the good news we proclaim through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And at the bottom of page 16, we pray together. Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace, and opened the gates. May we who share Christ's body live this risen moment. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We who in the Spirit lives give life to the world. Keep us firm in the fold of the second so that we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name through Christ our Lord. And now may the Spirit of truth lead you into all truth. give you grace to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, and strengthen you to proclaim the word and the works of God. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you this day and forevermore. Amen. Our final hymn is number 752. Will you come and follow me if I but call your name? 752.
Come, follow me, if I will call your name. The field of work you've done, the Lord, yet will be the same. Where you let my love be shown, where you let my way be known, where you let my life be known, would you let it be? You yourself behind if I could hold your name. Will you tell whole that I can never be the same? Will you rinse the house with your life and try to stay? Will you let me not separately be the same? When you let the heart in sin, I control your name. When you set the distance free, I'll never be the same. When you place a man on me, and do such as this and see, and get me to what I need in you, and you make me. Father, if you are the father of your name, will you crown the fear inside of me the same? Will you use the pain you found to reshape the world and come to my sight and touch and sound in you? The summons echoes to a different home, my name. Let me tell them for a view and never be the same. In your company, your home, when your love and footsteps show, the sound in my dream, I know in you and you.
Reminder, we will serve tea and coffee. You're very welcome, in fact, warmly invited to join us after the service, and I will have tickets for the Narrowly Triggered concert as well if you want. But now let's go in the peace of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia. Thanks. Alleluia, alleluia. It catches you out. Which might, next week we go back into the normal one. Enjoy the rest of your Sunday.